Hello everyone, thanks for joining me on this adventure. We're looking at special relativity. And today, a very important lecture, I want to try to explain a very elementary approach to thinking about special relativity that doesn't involve any equations, but I give you enough structural, intuitive understanding of what's going on so that you can go off on your own and just with high school, maybe first year maths, derive essentially the equations for special relativity. All right? So we're going to simplify things dramatically by stripping away all unnecessary and complicated things and just thinking about physics in a very elementary way. Just a one-dimensional space devoid of everything pretty well except for just one or two observers and maybe a few things to observe. And we're going to step away from the conundrums of the meanings of fundamental terms like mass and force and energy and even things like time and space. So we're going to do that by adopting a very simple kind of story where there's only sound. Okay, so this is like a one-dimensional tunnel in which we have bats. And the bats are just listening to things. They emit little clicks. The clicks bounce off something and then they receive the click. And from that information alone, they make some deduction as to what was out there. So that's all what we're going to have. So we're not adopting the idea of an inertial frame, importantly, okay? So that's a very crucial idea in Newtonian mechanics, the idea that there's a rigid system of coordinates for space and also for time, which is also adopted by Einstein to a great extent, right? This idea of an inertial frame, some ongoing sequence of equally spaced rods, let's say, with clocks attached. Okay? I don't think that's really representative of the way we are in our universe. We're really more like point observers here on planet Earth. And the idea of some massive inertial frame extending beyond our solar system or our galaxy is fanciful to me. And it imposes already assumptions on the story that we don't really need. So we're going to stick with just these point observers. Okay, that's a really important point. And we're going to let go of Einstein's dependence on light. Okay. Einstein actually did recognize that there were alternatives to using light as a framework. In fact, let me quickly quote here. This is the meaning of special relativity, a book he wrote in 1922. And so he says at some point, the theory of relativity is often criticized for giving without justification a central theoretical role to the propagation of light, in that it founds the concept of time upon the law of propagation of light. The situation, however, is somewhat as follows. In order to give physical significance to the concept of time, processes of some kind are required which enable relations to be established between different places. It is immaterial what kind of processes one chooses for such a definition of time. It is advantageous, however, for the theory to choose only those processes concerning which we know something certain. This holds for the propagation of light in vacuo in a higher degree than for any other process which can be considered, thanks to the investigations of Maxwell and Lorentz. So he's at least opening the door here that we could be talking about special relativity in the context of other propagation methods, and that's what we're going to be doing here in this lecture. That has several advantages in that it makes it more obvious that this additional postulate of Einstein, or sometimes it's maybe considered a deduction, that nothing can go faster than the speed of light, is really not logically justified. Okay, that's not logically justified. It is not an intrinsic part of special relativity, even though it's often presented as such. And in fact, the second postulate, which is that the speed of light is constant in any reference frame, in any inertial reference frame, that also is questionable, actually. Okay, because, well, the meaning of that is first of all in question. What do we mean by the velocity of anything? In the Galilean system, velocity doesn't have any meaning. And even if you do ascribe some local meaning, well, you still have the problem of comparing relative units in systems or inertial frames which are moving at speeds with respect to each other. So that postulate also, to me, doesn't really play an essential role in the story. And that's going to be the same here. And what about Einstein's first postulate? Well, that's really just Galileo. That's really just Galileo's invariance principle. So, the reality is that the equations of special relativity are really follow really just from Galileo, with some sort of simple-minded arguments that I'm going to show you today, having to do with one-dimensional physics. All right, so let's start with a bat A. Here's a bat A, and the bat A is interested in making some observations and deductions about the world. So maybe there's some particles over here. Or maybe there's a second bat B over here, which the bat A is interested in observing. So the bat A does not have a prior notion of a clock. So the first order of business is, as Einstein suggests, to establish a clock. And a rudimentary way of doing this is to use a mirror which can reflect the sound. Okay, so let's say that A has a fixed mirror at some close location to him, and he's clicking, click, the sound comes back, and then as soon as the sound comes back, he makes another click, and so the sound bounces back and forth, establishing a rudimentary kind of clock. So then to ascribe some numbers to this situation, the bat could say, all right, let's say if we start at time zero, then the receiving click, the next one that we get, let's call that time t equals 2. If we do that, then we can posit that at time t equals 1, it got to the mirror. Now, actually, we don't know, you know, when it actually got to the mirror, because we're not at the mirror, we're over here. But nevertheless, the bat can define that the time at which the reflection took place at the mirror was at time t equals 1. And that's consistent with, say, defining this unit between the bat and the mirror to be the unit of length, or better, displacement in the spatial direction. Okay, so the mirror and the bouncing of sound back and forth from the bat to the mirror, that little setup is sufficient to introduce the idea of time, indeed to define time observationally, okay, and also to establish at least a unit of displacement in this one-dimensional direction. So that's already a pretty good start. So now what's going to happen if we want to observe some, maybe a mosquito buzzing around over there somewhere, or maybe it's a ball bearing, you know, moving towards another ball bearing. There's going to be a collision here soon, and we want to make some observations having to do with some dynamics. You know. But before we do that, we should have a way of figuring out, you know, where and when things are occurring. So what's the bat going to do? The bat is going to send out sound waves, say send out a signal at T1, to the right. So let's agree that at T1, the signal is emitted to the right. It bounces off whatever, and then comes back, say at T2, moving to the left, coming back. Okay, so that's all that the bat has, is these two measurements, T1 and T2, when the signal to the right was sent off and when it comes back. What can the bat deduce from that? Well, in parallel to what it did over here, it can first of all deduce or ascribe a time value to the event of the reflection of the sound off the object, namely the average of T1 and T2, T1 plus T2 over 2. And that's exactly the argument that Einstein used in his 1905 paper. He used it in the context of calibrating clocks over here with the clock over here. But in fact, we can use that to dispense with the clocks over there. We don't need the clocks over there, right? If we have this very clear way of finding time values for distant events. We only need the time value here, the clock over here. That's all what we really need. Okay? So already this idea of inertial frame having clocks, you know, scattered all around, it's overkill. You don't need those clocks. You just need one clock. Because you are able to send signals and receive them. Okay, what about the position of the event where the sound hits the mosquito or ball bearing and comes back? Where did that happen? Well, we started at time T1. The signal came back at time T2. That's a total time of T2 minus T1. In analogy with what we did over here, remember we sent a signal at time t equals 0 and received it at time t equals 2. The difference is 2 minus 0, and we divided that by 2 to get the position to be equal as 1. We'll do exactly that. We'll say that, okay, this thing is going to define a position coordinate, say x, of t2 minus t1 over 2. If you like, that's a definition. That's the definition of the x-coordinate, as far as bat A is concerned, of an event of a ball bearing being in a certain place, and that place is t2 minus t1 over 2. So, to summarize, okay, the heart of the matter, this is the heart of the whole story, is that if we have a signal going to the right at t1, coming back at t2, then the time coordinate of the event that's being registered is the average t1 plus t2 over 2, and the x-coordinate, position, is minus t1 plus t2 over 2. And I write it that way so that it immediately syncs with what I told you in previous lecture on green complex numbers. It's exactly the transformation between the 1k basis vectors in green geometry and the n1, n2 basis vectors that we were talking about, that I said was sort of central, okay? So it's exactly the same story. So now we have an unambiguous way of going from t1 and t2 to t and x. Great. So now what can bat A do? Well, bat A can talk about the velocity now. It's velocity with respect to him, okay? So, for example, he could look at this particle C1 and make 2 different measurements at different times and record time and x coordinates for this thing at 2 different places, and then could compute in the regular way what the velocity of that thing is. He could also apply the same thing, say, to bat B. And bat B perhaps is moving with respect to bat A. Okay, bat B maybe is moving in this direction, maybe. So from bat A's point of view, perhaps bat B is moving in this direction. And so then bat A can, you know where bat B is at a certain amount of time. Let's say that bat B is moving uniformly. A could decide, oh, you're moving uniformly with constant velocity. Okay, so bat A is now in possession of having the tools to, for example, investigate some physics, some dynamics. So, for example, he could look at these two particles, C1 and C2, and could figure out what their initial velocities are. They seem to be approaching each other, and now they collide, and then they come back apart. But how they actually do that suggests that maybe one of them is bigger than the other in some sense. Okay, so just these time position measurements are going to allow bat A to make some deductions about collisions, and maybe make some deductions, depending on his theory, of relative masses of, say, these two particles. Okay. And now let's turn from bat A to bat B. Here is bat B with a similar setup. Bat B also has a mirror. Bat B has exactly the same idea of using sound bouncing off between it and its mirror to establish a clock. And then bat B can make exactly the same computations that bat A is making. And bat B can look at bat A and notice that, oh, bat A is moving in that direction. Okay, so as far as bat B is concerned, bat A is not stationary, it's moving in that direction. And bat B could tell bat A how fast it's moving, in the same way that bat A could formerly have told bat B how fast she is moving. But now the interesting story happens. We have 2 different ways of describing some third independent event. Say, you know, what's happening to this particle C1? When these two things collide, where do they collide? When do they collide? Well, A and B are going to have different answers to that question. But we can figure out the relationships between the time and position coordinates of events of A and the time and position coordinates of B. When we do that, I claim that we get the Lorentz transformations. The Lorentz transformations are nothing but an elementary first year university, it's probably actually high school stuff, working out what are the relationships between the time-space coordinates of bat A and the time-space coordinates of bat B of some event. What about those fancy things of special relativity like, you know, length contraction, time dilation, the relativistic addition of velocities? Those are all immediate consequences of the Lorentz transformation, and they apply in this situation just as much as they do in the Einstein situation with light. It's ultimately a Galilean phenomena, which is a consequence of the fact that we are assuming that these two bats have a symmetrical position. Neither of them has a prior or privileged position with respect to the world in which they are in. They are both equally valid ways of looking at the world. And then when we get to dynamics, when we start talking about interactions of particles, momenta, energies, masses, forces perhaps, then again the same kind of reasoning leads us to relativistic notions of what are usually called four momenta vectors, and ultimately relations like E equals mc squared. So I claim that E equals mc squared is not something that is just a phenomena related to light. It's a phenomena that's going to happen in this very general situation. So there's an E equals mc squared here, but the c, in this case, which is the speed of sound, is one. At least it's one for this bat. So I've given you enough information now that if you are reasonably proficient undergraduate, you can sit down and you can work this all out. Really, all what you need is first year, maybe a little bit of first year linear algebra. And if you've watched my red and green complex number stories, well, the thing will be dramatically simplified because the equations are almost right there, okay? So it's not very hard. Dealing with the dynamics is a little bit trickier, but if you think about that without prior conceptions, you very well may be able to discover all of that stuff yourself. So this is a really great opportunity to come to grips with essential physics. Like, you know, we're really getting at the heart of elementary physics here without prior suppositions, letting go of Einstein's postulates, except for the really important one, Galileo's invariance principle. Galileo is really the hero here. Einstein was also very important, but ultimately, for special relativity, the critical understanding was already contained in Galileo. And it's just that people didn't take that seriously enough because of the dramatic success of Newtonian physics, which is pretty obviously at odds with the Galilean principle. But it's so successful that people said, okay, well, let's forget about the Galilean principle, okay? And Einstein was the first person who had the insight, or maybe Poincaré and Lorentz also to a certain extent. These guys had the insight to realize that it was really the Galilean principle which was at the heart of the matter.